are you ready to come before God just as you are? You don't have to change. You don't have to do anything different. Just come like you are. Isn't that the coolest thing? I woke up this morning thinking that. It's like, I just, like, Jesus doesn't expect anything of us. He just says, come. Just come. And I was thinking today, too, about, you know, we've talked the last few weeks about the changes that we feel like we have to make because we're Christians, right? So we need to be changing it up. But do you know that every single one of those is for your best interest? Like, okay, it benefits God, but no, it's for our own good. Every single thing that God asks us to do is for our own good. And when you stop and think about that, that's just really, really cool. Did you switch that, the camera? I remembered Facebook. I remembered I'm not going to leave you on the screen this week. Huh? Oh, okay. So that's fine then. As long as, I thought it was still on the screen. Oh, okay. We're good then. So if you're on Facebook, tell me you're here. I want to see, I'd like to see those, your name on there and stuff. So we've talked the last few weeks about making marks on the wall. We've talked about salvation. We've talked about taming your tongue. We've talked about growing through giving. We've talked about forgiving. We've talked about a lot of things. And we know that growing is not easy, right? It's just not easy. Even as a little kid, growing is not easy. Did you know that there are some kids that actually physically it hurts to grow? Yeah, growing pains. Now, doctors say that it shouldn't hurt. They can't figure out any reason why kids hurt. But there are some kids who have literal growing pains. Julia used to have them terrible. Like, every night, I for a long time, I just thought she was, like, trying to get away with something. Because every night, something different would hurt. one day, her leg would hurt. And the next day, her arm would hurt. And I'm pretty sure. But no, it's a real thing. It hurts to grow. And we don't know why. Doctors, they don't think. But it hurts. And then, the older you get, the more responsibility you have. Or should have. If you don't, then your parents weren't doing something right. You should, the older you get, the more responsibility that you have. At two, we probably have to start at least helping to pick up our own toys, right? By the time we're four or five, they expect us to pick up our toys without any help, right? You know, more and more responsibility. My kids, by the time they were two, they were responsible to fold socks. I hated to fold socks, so I would put all the socks in a big basket or a small basket, and they, at 2 years old, they could sort and fold socks. So they took care of the socks from the time they were two until the next kid turned two. So for a good little while there, I didn't have to do anything with the socks. And then after that, they had to fold their own socks, and I only had mine and Steve's socks to fold. I didn't like to fold socks. By the time my kids were four or five, it was their job to feed the dog. If they didn't feed the dog didn't get fed. That was their job. They had responsibility. And then you have these whole other set of responsibilities once you turn 16, right? Once you turn 16, then you've got a whole new set of responsibilities. People expect you to start taking care of yourself. I know. They do. By the time my kids were 17 or 18, they usually had jobs, and they actually started buying their own stuff. Like, if it was something that the whole family did not use, they bought their own. Because the older you get, the more responsibility you have. And watching your children take responsibility, it's a blessing. It you don't think it's a blessing? Oh. But for me, it was a blessing to see them take on responsibility. By the time, I still remember when Sylvia, like, started she worked at a grocery store, and she started buying stuff for the family. Like, she would bring home the milk and the bread because she was making money. And so she was already at the store because she worked there. So she would bring the stuff home that we needed between grocery visits. I remember the day that Julia and Travis bought their house. They were only just barely 18. And they bought their own house. I still remember the day Monica, she wasn't even very old. I mean, she was probably 13, 14, 15 years old. She called me at work. Now, you need to know that to call me at work, somebody had to be bleeding or dying. That was the rule. If you're calling me at work, there better be somebody in serious trouble on the other end of the phone. So she calls and she's like, Mom, I'm so sorry I'm calling you. But I need to know, what do I use to scrub the porch down? So we extended the rule. Anytime you want to do extra work, you're allowed to call me to ask me how to do that. Right? Yeah, all by herself without me asking. She wants to know how to scrub the porch down. And she scrubbed all the siding down on the porch. Like, you know. So I remember these milestones, and I felt blessed because I knew my kids were getting older and they were taking on responsibility. And I wonder, how does God feel when he sees us taking on more responsibility, when he sees us making those marks on the wall because he knows we're getting older? And in the spiritual growth, it's the same way. Because what happens when we start to take responsibility is we begin to realize that the world does not revolve around us. That's what responsibility does. Responsibility enables us to see that there are other people in the world who we need to help, right? Responsibility is never selfish. Responsibility is always for someone else. We're always taking care of someone else or looking out for someone else. That's what responsibility is. And the same is true with spiritual growth. After we get so mature, if we want to keep growing, we have to start thinking of others. It says in Philippians 3, you missed that one, huh, Elizabeth? It says in Philippians 3, now I hope in the Lord Jesus to send Timothy to you soon, so that I also may be encouraged when I hear news about you. For I have no one else like-minded who will genuinely care about your interests. All seek their own interests, not those of Jesus Christ. But you know his proven character, because he has served me in the gospel ministry like a son with a father. Wouldn't you love for someone to write that about you? I'm sending him to you because I know that he has your best interest in mind. And Timothy was not very old. At one point, Paul wrote to him and said, don't let anybody look down on you because you're so young. So Timothy was very young, and yet Paul had no one else that he could send who was so mature that they would look out after someone else's best interest. As we grow, we have to change. We can't be like those people that Paul said. Did you hear that? Paul said, everyone else is looking out for their own interests. We can't be like that anymore. We can't be the kind of people, like, I've been in churches where they wonder why they're not growing, and the main reason is they won't give up their seat. Really? The only thing they care about is whether or not their seat is available when they get there. So if a guest comes in and is sitting in their seat, they will say, excuse me, but you're sitting in my seat. No, they don't usually take those front seats. What? They're being like Sheldon. Exactly, exactly. And how welcome do you think people feel when you tell them they have to move because you're in their seat? Yeah. That was different. Yeah, we can't be thinking about ourselves all the time. There are people who, you know, they don't want to change the time of the service because that would be inconvenient. We can't be like that. We have to be thinking about what would be the best thing for other people so that they want to meet Jesus. That has to be where our mindset goes. But so much of the world has their own interest in heart. Why do you think there are so many wars? who are also happy. Because everybody's looking out for number two. Not number one, because number one is Jesus. You might think you're number one, you're not. Jesus is number one. But everybody's looking out for themselves. That's why there are wars. I want that person's land, I deserve it. I want to control those people, I deserve it. I'm better than those people, so I'm going to destroy. I mean, every war. That's what it's been caused by. People not looking out for other people's interests. During an election, do you vote for the person who would be the best for the whole region that you're voting for, whether it be the country or the county or whatever? Or do you vote for the person who has your best interest at heart? Because most of the country, when they vote for president, they don't vote for the person who is best for the whole country. They vote for the person who would be best for them personally. We have to get to the place where we quit that. Up further in Philippians 2, in the third and fourth verse, it says, "Do nothing out of rivalry or conceit, but in humility consider others as more important than yourselves. Everyone should not look out for his own interests, but also for the interests of others." Do you consider others more important to than yourselves? It's tough. It's tough to think about people. And here's the thing. Sometimes it's not hard. Sometimes we walk into a room and we feel less important because we think there are people there who are more important. So sometimes it's easy. But what about when you see that guy living on the street? Do you think you're more important? What about the prostitute standing on the corner? Do you think you're more important? What about the mass murderer sitting in jail? Do you think you're more important? Do you want to look out for their best interests? I'm not sure I want to look out for the best interests of the murderer. That's just my personal thing. Just not sure that that's where I want to go. But Paul didn't put any stipulations on here. He says everyone should look out not only for his own interest, but also the interest of others. He didn't say other people you like. He didn't say other people who are like you. But you know what? A baby Christian can't do that, right? You can't do that when you're first saved. You have to grow into it. So we need to look and see, like, how long have I been a Christian? Are there more people now that I look out for their best interests than there used to be? I'm not quite to murderer yet. I can probably look out for the best interests of the prostitutes and the guy living on the street. I'm just not quite murderer yet. Not quite there yet. You know? Haven't quite made that mark on the wall. But where is your mark? Where's that line that you can say, yeah, I can look out for their best interest, but not their best interest. I don't really care about their best interest. Because that's where your mark's falling on the wall. And here's how we do it. We ask Jesus to start letting us see people through his eyes. Because when we can see people through the eyes of Jesus, we see them different. And that's true humility. Because true humility understands that thinking of others as more important doesn't make you less important. Did you hear that? Thinking of others as more important does not make you less important in the kingdom. That's not how it works. Because God doesn't think you're less important. He doesn't. He still thinks you are so important. But we need to start looking at others as more important. What would happen if the world would start seeing other people as more important than them? What would happen if all those people in the Middle East who are fighting over we don't know what begin to say, you know what? That person is more important than I am. That would change the whole way the world works. But you know what? The world is not going to change as long as the church doesn't change. Hebrews, the writer of Hebrews, he gave us the answer to the problem. He said, in fact, though by this time you ought to be teachers, you need someone to teach you the elementary truths of God's word all over again. You need milk, not solid food. You see, we still want milk. We don't want meat and potatoes. And milk are the elementary teachings. Milk is salvation. Milk is forgiveness. Milk is pretty much everything that we've talked about up till tonight. It's been milk. They're the basics. They're just the things that a basic Christian should know about. But once you start to get into the meat and potatoes, you start to realize, I got to start thinking about other people. I've got to start worrying about if other people are going to make it to heaven or not. I have to start living my life in such a way that other people want to know Jesus. The writer of Hebrews said we ought to be teachers. So, how many of you guys feel like you could be a teacher? Yeah. We need to get there. If you are on solid food, you need to be a teacher. Now, some people are called and gifted to teach Bible studies and to teach groups and to teach other adults. Some people are gifted and called to teach children. But let me tell you what, you're all called to teach someone. It might just be the other people in your house. It might be the people you work with. If you have kids, I will guarantee you 100% it's kids. If your kids have a foul mouth, guess what you've been teaching them? Because you can blame the school, but I will tell you what, a kid who knows they aren't allowed to use the name of the Lord in vain at home, they won't do it outside the house either. Because it just becomes a habit. It doesn't matter how many times I heard, because there wasn't a lot of cussing when I was in school, but the Lord's name in vain went all over the place when I was a kid. And you know what? I never did. Never, ever, ever, ever. Because my mother would have, I don't even want to think. Mama, you can put in the comments, because I know you're watching. You can put in the comments what you would have done, because I don't know what you would have done. I never tried it. I knew it would not turn out good, so I didn't even try that. I knew that sometimes when I snuck down the steps to watch TV, you could sneak down our steps and sit on the corner of the steps and see the television. And sometimes we would do that. I knew that if we got caught, there was a belt coming off. I knew that. Now, I never, ever got the belt on me, but I did have it unbuckled a few times. So I assumed that somewhere in the Lord's name in vain was a belt at the other end of that. So I never did it. So what are you teaching your kids? We are all teachers, or we ought to be teachers. But if we are still drinking the milk, if we're still caught in those elementary teachings, we can't teach. Our testimony teaches. We share our story, and it teaches someone else what Jesus has done. Our lifestyle teaches. Are you living in a way that lines up with Scripture? Which is why you can't stay in the milk. You got to get in the meat and potatoes so that you know what your lifestyle is supposed to be. But your lifestyle, if your lifestyle does not line up with Scripture, what are you teaching people? What are you teaching the kids around you? But it all goes back to putting others' interests and needs ahead of yours. We're going to probably, the plan is to start two services in at Easter. And what that will mean is I have to be here by 8 o'clock on Sunday mornings. Yes, for those of you on Facebook, some of them are laughing. My mother is probably laughing because I have never been a morning person. Never. When I went to school, the bus went down and past our house, and then it picked me up on the way back. Now, my mother would start start yelling up the stairs a good half hour, 45 minutes before that happened. I normally got out of bed when she yelled, "Lynn, the bus just went down the road," which meant I had about 7.5 minutes to get dressed and out the door. Because I'm not a morning person. Now, if I was just looking out for my best interests, 8 o'clock service, or me being here at 8 o'clock for a service would not happen. But you know what? I want people to find Jesus. I want them to know the abundant life that Jesus has for them. I want them to know that there is more to life than just surviving. I want them to find the joy and the peace that is found in Jesus Christ. And so you know what? I'm going to be here at 8 o'clock. I'll be perfectly honest with you. On Sunday mornings, I'm normally not even out of bed at 8 o'clock. See, he's shaking his head back there. No. No, I get up at like about 10 after 8. We leave home at 10 after 9. But you know what? If it means that more people will come to know Jesus Christ, if more people will have the peace and joy and abundance that Jesus gives them, you know what? I'm going to be here. Because I want to put others ahead of myself. You can't do that. You can't teach if you're living in sin. Now, we all have some sin in our life, but that sin should get smaller and smaller, and they should get less. In God's eyes, there aren't big sins and little sins. However, in humans, there are. Like, murder's pretty big, right? That's pretty big. Sleeping in, that's pretty small, right? But these are humans. These are not godly things. But they should get this less consequential as we go, because they should hurt people less. Our sins should hurt people less, because the more that the Holy Spirit reigns in us, the smaller the sin gets. Because you know what? There is not room for sin and the Holy Spirit. You want more Holy Spirit? You got to give up some sin, because there's not room for both of it. And the Holy Spirit is where we get the blessings. The Holy Spirit is where we get the abundance. So if you feel like you aren't growing, you need to ask Jesus, "Lord, what sin am I hanging on to? What sin is it that I just keep hanging on to that I won't give up?" And then ask God to help us, help you. We have to give up those things that are keeping the Holy Spirit out. One of the things that the Bible calls it is laying down your life. 5 times in Scripture, John tells us we have to lay down our life. 4 of those times, he was quoting Jesus. Jesus said, "I am the good shepherd." The good shepherd, what? Lays down his life for the sheep. He said, "Just as the Father knows me and I know the Father, and I lay down my life for the sheep." Jesus laid down his life for us. He said, "The reason the Father loves me is that what? I lay down my life only to take it up again." Jesus laid down his life for us. He gave his life for you. That, all by itself, should be reason enough to make these marks on the wall. It should just be out of appreciation for what Jesus did. But if that's not enough reason for you, I want you to know that if you are not making marks on the wall, you are missing out on the blessings of Jesus Christ. Jesus wants to bless you. And that should be enough to convince you it's time to start eating solid food. Amen? But now all those verses talked about Jesus laying down his life, right? And we sort of expect that. We know Jesus did that. I wish it was that easy. Because then in John 15, he said, "Greater love has no one than this, to lay down one's life for one's friends." What did he do? He put it on you. Greater love has no one than this, but that you lay down your life for your friends. And then he said, this is how we know what love is. You want to know what love is? Here it is. Jesus Christ laid down his life for us. And what? And we ought to lay down our lives for our brothers and sisters. Have you ever laid down your life for someone? Have you ever put the interests of others ahead of your own? Because that's what laying down your life is. You don't have to die to lay down your life. Dying, I tell you what, dying is sometimes an easier way to lay down your life. Because you know what? It's hard sometimes. It's very difficult. Laying down a life is a parent who gives up a lucrative career so they can stay home and raise their own kids. That's laying down your life. Laying down your life is when you rush in to an accident or a building to save someone, disregarding your own life. That's laying down your life. Policemen, military, firemen, they lay down their life every day. They don't know when they go to work if they're going to be able to come home or not. That's laying down your life. Laying down your life is when you are more worried about what is going to happen to someone else than what's going to happen to you. That's laying down your life. Now, parents do it almost every day. Parents give up stuff for their kids all the time. Grandparents, aunts, uncles, they give up stuff for those little ones around them all the time. So most of you know a little bit about what laying down your life is. But will you do it for a stranger? Because laying down your life for those people that you already love, well, that's easy. Peter said everybody does that. Maybe James. That might have been James. One of them said, everybody does that. Even the heathens will lay down their lives for people that they love. Shoot, gang members will lay down their life for another gang member, right? But will you lay down your life for a stranger? Will you lay down your life for those people who basically don't deserve it? In Romans chapter 9, Paul gives us a little look about laying down your life. He said, I have intense sorrow and continual anguish in my heart. Now listen to this. Pay attention. Are you listening? For I could almost wish to be cursed and cut off from the Messiah for the benefit of my brothers, my own flesh and blood. They are Israelites. And to them belong the adoption, the glory, the covenants, the giving of the law, the temple service, and the promises. You see, the Jews would not accept Jesus as the Savior. The Jews believed that Jesus was a blasphemer. And when Paul says, my own flesh and blood, he doesn't mean his dad and his mom and his cousin. No. He meant a whole nation of people. People he hadn't even met yet. And he said, I would give up my salvation if it meant they could be saved. He said, I would go to hell if it meant that those people could be saved. I'm not there yet, folks. I'm not willing to go to hell for you. I love you a lot. I'm willing to get up at 8 a.m. for you. Or I guess that'll be 6 or 7 a.m. I have to get up. I'm going to be here by 8. But, you know, I'm willing to do that. But I don't have that mark yet. I got a lot of marks, but I don't have that one yet. But that's what laying down your life looks like. It looks like being willing to go to hell so someone else can go to heaven. Who do you know that needs to go to heaven? It's a hard place to get to. But we have to keep growing. And if we're willing to keep growing, we will get there. But are you willing to do the work to grow? Are you willing to be reading scripture? Are you willing to keep in prayer? Are you willing to be in fellowship? I love that you guys are on Facebook. But unless you have a reason that you can't drive after dark, you should be here. In this building. Because that's how we grow. We grow through fellowship. If you've never asked the Holy Spirit to come in and live in you, if you haven't given up sin so the Holy Spirit can live in you, you're not growing. So tonight, I want to challenge you. I want to challenge you to surround yourself with people who will nourish you. I want to challenge you to make a commitment. You know, there are now only 7 Sundays left in this year. 7. And I challenged people on Facebook last week to just 8 Sundays. Get in church for 8 Sundays and see if it makes a difference in your life. Because when we start walking toward Jesus, he starts blessing us. Do you want to be blessed? Do you want to grow in Christ? So we're going to pray. And if you want to be different, if you really and truly want to do something different, I'm going to ask you to come up and sit up front or something, or stand up. And if you want Steve to come pray with you, he's going to keep his eyes open and you can wave him down and he can come pray with you. But we have to do something to make a difference. I don't know what your next mark on the wall is, because it's different than my next mark on the wall. But if you're ready to make that next mark, do it tonight. Don't wait. Don't say, I'll do that tomorrow or the next day. I'm going to do that one of these days. No, do it tonight. Is there some sin that you know, I shouldn't be doing this? Tonight's the night. Tonight's the night to get rid of that. Is there somebody that you've been supposed to lay down your life for and you've been putting it off because sometimes it's scary? Or maybe you've been putting it off because you don't really like them a whole lot. You know, because sometimes God calls us to lay down our lives for people we don't like a whole lot. Tonight's the night. So will you pray with me? And like I said, Steve's going to keep his eyes open. If you want him to pray, stand up, come up here and sit in the front, go back to where he is. But if you're going to make a difference tonight, if you want to make a difference, I encourage you to stand up when you pray. Because that way you're telling the whole group, I'm changing. I'm going to be different tonight. I'm going to do something different. So let's pray. Lord God, I thank you and praise you that you take us exactly how we are. That, Lord God, you don't expect anything of us. And you love us just the way we are. But I thank you, Lord Jesus, that you don't want us to stay that way. That, Lord, you have bigger and better things in store for us. I thank you and praise you for that. I thank you, Lord, that you have so much more than we can even imagine. And I ask, Father, that tonight your Spirit would just speak to each of our hearts. Lord, whatever mark I need to put on the wall next, I pray you'll speak to my heart. Whatever mark I need to be working on, Lord, I pray, Father God, that you will just tell me. Because, Lord, I want to make the next mark. I want to grow. I want to be bigger and better. I want to be all that you've created to be, to to be. I want your spirit to just overwhelm me and give me all of you. And I want there to be room for all of you, Father God. Lord, I want there to be room for all of you. Lord Jesus, let your spirit just move tonight, Lord. Father, make us different. Lord, reveal to us the sin that separates us, the sin that keeps the Holy Spirit out. Show us, Lord Jesus, show us. Father, show us the people who need you. Show us the people, Lord, that need us to lay down our lives. Show us the people that you've called us to teach. Let us. Let us tell our story. So as we sing, feel free to just keep.